More now on the Armstrong story and why he may have changed his mind about his admission to Oprah Winfrey and potentially others. It comes from two writers who've long followed his career. Juliet Macur has been covering this for the New York Times, and Daniel Coyle, co-author of The Secret Race, The Hidden World of the Tour de France. Juliet Macur, why do you think Lance Armstrong is talking in this way to Oprah Winfrey and talking now when just a few months ago, when the report came out, he denounced it?
Yeah, it's a pretty dramatic turn after so many years. Really, it's been almost 15 years of these vehement denials that he's never doped, that he's sued people that claimed he had doped, and he won those lawsuits. I mean, he's threatened people who said he is doped, and finally he's going to come out and say that he did it, only because he wants to compete again. Right now he's been banned from all Olympic sports for life, and the only way he could get back into competition is to tell the truth and say he was doping and to help the U.S. Anti-Doping Agency build cases against other people. And in doing that, he could possibly return to competition in as soon as 8 years.
So, Daniel Coyle, are there a lot of things Lance Armstrong knows but hasn't said that could still get a lot of other people into trouble? Sponsors, business partners, people who were involved in one way or another with his years on the postal team.
Nobody knows more than Lance. He was the kingpin. He was the Tony Soprano of this world for a long time. So he does stand to contribute a lot to the investigation, if he will. That's the question. How much? How much will he hedge? How much will he admit? How much will he share freely? And the biggest signal he's sending now, as David Hellman pointed out, is that he's taking his story not to the authorities, not to the governing body, but to Oprah.
But by taking it to Oprah, it is obviously extrajudicial in the most extreme way. But does it pique the interest of agencies, other bodies that can now have an opening to ask him once again about things he's talked about for years but denied?
I think that's true. But in the larger sense, this is part of a pattern that we saw in the book that we wrote about Lance Armstrong and about this secret race. You know, he gets into a tight spot and he makes an instinctive attack. You know, he's been fueled by anger, by defiance for a long time. And this is his attempt to sort of show the world that he's still strong. It's not really about disclosure for him. It's about this old instinct that has fueled his rise and now is fueling his fall.
Juliet, for years, Lance Armstrong clung to this most tested athletes in sports, never failed a test identity, and used that as kind of a shield. But now this tempo of story saying, no, in fact, he did fail tests and may have had a role in suppressing those test results is leading up to the doors of the UCI, the international governing body. Are they in trouble?
They might be in trouble. If I were them right now, I would not be getting any sleep. I'd be sitting on the edge of my chair pretty nervous. There have been claims that Lance had bribed the UCI, the International Cycling Union, to hide some of his positive tests. And we don't know if that's true, but his claim of passing 500 to 600 tests is totally not true. For one, he's never taken that many tests. He's kind of inflated that number over the years. But the International Cycling Union may be in trouble. Perhaps USA Cycling, which is the national governing body, they might be in trouble. I mean, like Dan says, we have no idea what Lance will say, but we know that he has said that he knows where all the bodies are buried.
So, Juliet, is this bigger than Lance Armstrong now? No longer even solely about him anymore?
A lot of writers said it was really never about Lance to begin with, that he was just, well, he was the kingpin of his own little doping program, but cycling has really been rife with doping for many, many years, especially in the 90s. This could be a huge opening to cleaning up the sport of cycling if Lance comes out and tells everybody where he got the drugs, who helped him hide his positive drug tests and all those things. The sport could actually turn over a new leaf, but he has to come clean first to the officials.
So, Daniel Coyle, what else could happen? What will you be watching for when the Oprah show goes out?
I'll be most curious about seeing contrition. You know, an apology is something that involves genuine feeling, authenticity. It's a process, and we'll see if he's taking steps on that process. I'm most curious about what he says to the people who he ruthlessly went after for years for telling the truth. I'm really curious to hear what he says to them.
Because, in fact, he ended careers, got people blackballed in this little world of top-level professional cycling. It got pretty rough at times, didn't it?
He was ruthless. He approached life the same way he approached a bike race, which was to do everything in his power to win. You know, as Frankie Andreu said in the lead-in quote, he destroyed a lot of lives. He tried to end people's careers. He told people, I will end your career. I have a lot of money, I have a lot of time, and I will destroy you. That's a quote that he gave to a writer, an Italian writer. So that's the way he operated. And so we'll see what he's willing to, if this is turning over a new leaf, if this is more of a calculation, how much of this is apology and how much of this is strategy.
Juliet Macur, along with any possible apology, will there be lawyers sitting with full-size legal pads waiting for every word to see if this opens up new cases? Is there money to be clawed back? Assurances he made to sponsors and to international entities that could be shown to be false now and put him either in danger of fraud, breach of contract, other kinds of violation?
Yeah, I think there certainly will be a lot of his lawyers looking at what he says. Well, they already know what he says because he taped it a few days ago. But I also think that his bankers will be opening up the key to his safe. They're going to be owing a lot of money to many people once he comes clean. He's been named in several civil lawsuits, including a federal whistleblower lawsuit here in Washington, which could mean he has to repay tens of millions of dollars back to the U.S. Postal Service team, the U.S. Postal Service, which sponsored his team in the late 90s to early 2000s.
So I'll ask both of you quickly before we go, where does this leave both Lance Armstrong and the sport of cycling that he did so much to raise the profile of worldwide? Daniel?
Lance Armstrong's in uncharted territory. This is a place he's never been. He's faced some hard things, but this is completely different. It's sort of the start of a new and unknown chapter, and a lot will depend on what happens tomorrow. As far as the sport of cycling, it's improved a lot since those days. These are events that are a few years old. In some ways, it is an object lesson for the larger American sports. What cycling is going through, you'd have to be naive to think that the same problem doesn't exist in other win-at-all-costs cultures like the NFL.
And quickly, Juliet?
Well, Lance right now is trying to save himself, trying to save his foundation, trying to win the hearts back of Americans and trying to get back into the athletic competition again. But what he has to do is really take the big leap and to help bring down some of the bigger people in the sport who have been helping riders dope and hiding positive drug tests and taking bribes for probably dozens of years now. So he has to take the leap, and he could do a great service to cycling if he's honest.
Juliet Macur and Daniel Coyle, thank you both.
You're welcome.
Thank you.